thanks everybody for your patience. I would like to get proceedings going, and there's a few things I'd like to do. There are people zooming in. First of all, I would like to acknowledge that the University of Wollongong stands on the Dharawal country within the Yuin nation. On the lands we walk, we live and study, we acknowledge and respect the traditional custodians and cultural knowledge holders of these lands. So welcome to all, and I'd like to acknowledge the attendance, some of them remotely, of our UOW family, including the Vice Chancellor, Professor Trish Davidson, the Senior Deputy Vice Chancellor, Professor Joe Shikaro, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Research and Innovation, Professor Jenny Martin, Head of School of SMAS, Dr. Maureen Edwards, NIASRA Director, Professor Marika Batterham, and our advancement team, Belinda Muir and Monique Harper-Richardson. Engineering and Information Sciences Dean Alisi and Lewis have meetings today and send their apologies. The Statistical Science Lecture began in 2018 and is an annual event now made possible by a philanthropic donation to the School of Maths and Applied Statistics at the University of Wollongong. It showcases the interdisciplinary and key role a statistical scientist plays in extracting scientific knowledge from data in the presence of uncertainty. The Statistical Science Lecturer for 2021 is Scott Zeger. Scott is the John C. Malone Professor of Biostatistics and Medicine at the Johns Hopkins University and the Bloomberg School of Public Health and School of Medicine in Baltimore, Maryland, in the United States. I'd just like to tell you a little about Scott. Let me start by adding a personal note on how good it is to catch up with Scott again. We're both PhD graduates at Princeton University, and at a time when I was on leave at Princeton after I graduated, Scott was a PhD student there, and we shared a lot of good times, good beer, and good pizza. Scott's name is legend in the field of biostatistics. He is the university's co-director of Hopkins in Health. He conducts statistical research on regression analysis for correlated responses and on methods for precision medicine. He's made substantive contributions to our understanding of the effects on health of smoking and air pollution and the global etiology of children's pneumonia and other topics. He was the founding co-editor of Oxford University Press's journal Biostatistics and a co-winner of the 2015 Carl Pearson Prize from the International Statistical Institute for development of generalized estimating equations. Dr. Zeger, Scott is most proud though of his Golden Apple Awards, several from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School Student Assembly for Excellence in Teaching. I want to remind you there's a reception afterwards in the foyer, 12:15, 12:20. The title of Scott's talk is Saving Medical Dollars, Trillions at a Time, a Statistical Perspective. Thank you very much, Scott.
Thank you, Noel. It's a pleasure to be here. Can you hear me all right? And I'm going to share my screen. Let me see if we can see the slides. Can you see those slides all right?
Yes, perfect. Thank you, Scott.
All right, and I can still see the questions, so I think we'll put these over here and it'll be all right. Yep. All right, well, it's a real honor to be here. This is my third time visiting Australia as a on a statistical visit. And the first two times were in person. This is the first cyber visit, but I'm looking forward to this just as much as the others. It's a very vibrant and beautiful land, and I've always enjoyed my associations with people there. Noel said correctly, we were both students in the same department, and there was a very distinguished Australian statistician there who spoke only the Queen's perfect English, Geoffrey Watson, who Noel and I knew very well, and have connections going back many years, some of which I'll talk about at the end of this talk if there's some time. So this is probably something quite different for most of you. I know your group is really renowned for its work in physical sciences and in atmospheric research and spatial modeling of atmospheric processes, and it's certainly a very important topic. But this one today will also be an important topic, and I'm delighted to share some of the ideas with you. This title is a little bit of an inside joke. I'm a faculty member at a school called the Bloomberg School, and our tagline is written at the bottom of this slide, saving lives millions at a time. That was the chosen by one of our deans who in his career discovered that vitamin A supplementation of young children under the age of five prevents mortality, about 40% of children's mortality, both in Africa and parts of Asia. And so he always used to lard this over the other deans that the medical school saves one patient at a time, the nursing school saves one patient at a time, but the School of Public Health saves millions at a time. Hence this title, Saving Medical Dollars Trillions at a Time. Why stop at millions if you're going to tell a big tale? So anyway, it's a pleasure to be here and I hope you enjoy. Please feel free to interrupt me and as needed, and then we'll just take a little journey together. So here's a plot that shows in US dollars, the per capita annual medical expenditure in the OECD countries, of which both the United States and Australia are members, about the 41 richest countries in the world. And what's plotted here in each of these graphs is for one country at a time, their growth in per capita annual medical expenditures. And these are in $2,000, so they're constant dollars. So this is real growth. And you can see, of all the OECD countries, one of them, the light blue line, you'd be surprised to know that's the United States of America. We're an exceptional country, as you know, and we're exceptional in terms of the dollars that we spend on healthcare. And the difference between the United States value, if you go up to 2022, these data stop in 2018, but if you go up to 2022, the difference between the blue curve and the second most expensive curve, the red one, say, which I think is the Netherlands. That difference is $1.3 trillion per year for the United States, which is to say that if we could somehow still be number one, as we like to say we are, but just be slightly number one, we would spend $1.3 trillion less on healthcare each year than we currently do. So you might wonder, how big is $1.3 trillion? That's per year, right? Well, TikTok is worth, I think, $50 billion, right? So there's $200 billion, $250, $500, $750, $1 trillion, $1.3 trillion approximately. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times 5 is 25 TikToks, new TikToks every year. Imagine the younger people among you, how great that would be. Or if you want to put it in more local terms, the GDP of the great nation of Australia is $1.3 trillion. And that's the amount of money that the United States wastes in its medical care each year, $1.3 trillion. Now, when I say wastes, you know, typically what people say is, well, we just choose to spend more on that than other societies. But if you look at life expectancy or any other indicator of population health, it doesn't have to be life expectancy. It could be life expectancy once you've achieved the age of 65 or any number of other measures. We're the light blue line again. And you can see we have not been able to keep up with most of the wealthy OECD countries that were here with Turkey, Poland, Estonia, Slovakia, Hungary, Mexico, and Latvia. Those are the neighboring ones around the United States. So in terms of costs, we are $1.3 trillion more than we would be had we been the second most, tied for the first most expensive country. And in terms of life expectancy or other health outcomes, I think we're 26th out of 41. So it's reasonable to say that this money is being wasted. So there's lots of research. Before I go on, let me just say, you guys probably get, like we do in our department, lots of big data talks these days. This is just a big datum talk. It's a single number, $1.3 trillion. And so I'm here today to ask the question, what can people like us do about this situation? I know it's not a big issue in Australia, but it is a big issue in the United States. And the fact that we're wasting all this money has big impact on our politics and in other things in our nation that do have consequences around the world. So today what we're going to do is talk about that problem, the $1.3 trillion of waste. And what I'm really going to talk about is how to perhaps reorganize the use of information in healthcare to try to improve decisions made by clinicians and thereby reduce some of that waste. So I'm not going to spend any more time talking about this context, except to say that there's been lots of research about where that money goes, and about 40% of it goes to poor decisions to do things that don't add value to healthcare. So there's a lot of decisions being taken where the decision is to make an intervention that doesn't ultimately add value to healthcare. So the possibility exists that for a third of that money, we could, if we could improve the information use in healthcare decisions, we might be able to reduce a substantial fraction. So that's what the talk is about and the role of statistics. I'm going to talk next about what it means to be a clinician and how to make a how clinicians use data to make decisions. And we're just going to look at that together. And then I'm going to talk about a way to improve decisions by bringing standard statistical methods to bear at the place when decisions are being made. And then we're going to talk generically about that. And then I'm going to either talk to you about autoimmune disease or about COVID-19, but we won't have time for both. I've put both in the slides for those who want to read more, but we'll see how we feel when we get there. If you have a strong opinion about it, just vote your conscience and maybe we'll pay attention to it before we decide. Okay, and then we'll have time for some questions and answers. So there's a in vogue today is this notion in the United States that we should become a learning healthcare system. And what does that mean? It just means that when we practice medicine, here we are looking at a doctor and a patient, I'll let you decide which one is which, or maybe it's a nurse and a patient. In deference to my great colleague, past colleague, who I know is here today, Patricia Davidson, and you're very fortunate to have her in your great university. And she really did wonders at Johns Hopkins when she was with us. I have to say I was on the search committee and I was so excited when she came to Hopkins. It really was a major positive advance for us, and you're lucky to have her back. I know she's happy to be back where she's from. Anyway, when she practices nursing or is sitting with a patient, there's a series of data that gets generated, measurements, family histories, and the like. That data is captured these days through electronic health records and other similar systems. That data can be analyzed and new knowledge generated. And then that new knowledge can be put back into practice. And this is what people call the learning healthcare system. And so what we're going to talk about today is exactly this virtuous cycle from practice back to practice, taking data and learning from it. So let me take you to, see if you can't see this. I want you to actually play nurse or doctor for a moment. It's like they do and say, I'm not a real doctor, I just play one on TV. But here we're all going to play the doctor. I want you to imagine that you're a clinician just for a moment. And what happens when you're a clinician? So what happens is someone makes an appointment to see you. They come into your office and they present you with some data, right? So let me just see if I can clean this up for a second. Okay. So here's an example. A 40-year-old man comes into your office. This man has no family history of a particular life-threatening disease. And they've they've done a screening test for that disease because you told them to do so. As their doctor, they turned 40, and that's the time when this test first gets used, and they tested positive for the disease. And they then tried to make an appointment to see you. It took 2 weeks. They're very worried. They have a young family. So there's a lot of concern. And they come to you into your office, and what do they ask? They say, doctor, do I have this disease or not? What is my disease state? And doctor, what should I do? What do you recommend that I do about this disease if I have it? So what's happened here? We have an individual patient. We have just generated some data about that patient. 40-year-old man, no family history, positive test, right? And you have a question put to you, what is my disease state? So what do you do as a clinician? You remember what you learned in medical school or nursing school, and you remember this 2x2 table that's shown here. It's called, even though there's like 9 numbers, it's called a 2x2 table because it's the data, the only data are here in the middle. And what it shows is for different true disease states, how this test performs, right? And if we focus in on this person tested positive. This whole table is for 40-year-old men with no family history. And now we focus in on the positive group. There were 1,000 people who took this test beforehand and tested positive, right? And of those 1,000, when we followed them forward and did some additional testing, a biopsy or something, we found that 15 of them actually had this disease, this life-threatening disease, and 985 didn't. So the answer to the question, what is my disease state, doctor, is, well, we don't know for sure. But what I can tell you is that for people like you, a very small fraction of them actually have the disease. So there's nothing for us to do at the moment. What we have to do is rule out the possibility that you're one of those rare cases. But what you should do in the short term is not worry about it, because the likelihood that you are going to have this disease is very small. So this is what it means to be a clinician. It means that you gather data about an individual. And then what you do is you reference that individual against a population of otherwise similar people for whom we know what happened. Right? And you bring to the patient the information about what this person's likelihood of having the disease or not, and you make decisions about what to do next or not based upon these likelihoods. This is an example of a screening test where we often do have data like this, but in most of medical practice, we're now being confronted with data that look like this, like genomic data or measurements of telomere lengths or longitudinal data over time for many biomarkers or images of the brain or other similar complex data. And so what this talk is about trying to create learning analogs of that simple 2x2 table, but for any kind of measurements, not just simple binary data, right? And any measurements that are relevant to a major medical decision. And so what we want to learn how to do is take the individual who's asking the questions about their health state and reference that person against this population of people, just as we did in that simple example. And then we want to be able to inform the individual from what we have learned from the population in real time, right? And the second thing we want to do is we want to be able to make these tables of population data that are brought to bear on an individual to be more ever narrowly defined to be otherwise similar. What I mean by that is we want to only compare to people who are as much like the individual as possible. And in these days we're getting, I'm sorry, this is jumping around on me. I'm using my pointer. And it's also my slide advancer, so I'm doing the best I can there. So we want to be able to compare the individual to people who are like that individual with respect to ever more refined definitions of otherwise similar, using similar genomic measures or other sorts of factors. And so the idea is to be able to create subsets of patients where people are similar to one another in the subsets and where we can learn about what's likely to happen for this individual from what happened in this more narrowly defined subset. So the goal of this talk is to say how we're going to do that. What we're going to do is talk about the tool we're going to use to do this referencing, so-called Bayesian hierarchical models. And John Tukey, Noel, and my professor always used to say, no models are true, some models are useful, or something to that effect. And a Bayesian hierarchical model is a very useful statistical model for the purposes of this problem. And I don't know, do you know Thomas the Tank Engine in Australia? You must, because it's a British TV show. Somebody say yes, or you know, I think you do. And I'm not going to play this music for you, but because it's childish for an old man like me to play this music, but I had to listen to it a lot with my kids were growing up. It used to drive me crazy. But the song says that Thomas is a very useful engine. He wasn't the fastest, he wasn't the shiniest, but he was very useful. And that's sort of like Bayesian hierarchical models. They're simple and very useful. So let me tell you how to think about a Bayesian hierarchical model. And I'm going to do so by drawing on this image called Plato's cave. Plato was a Greek philosopher. Plato's main idea was that there is what we observe in nature, and then there are the true forms that are sort of the perfections of the observed things in nature. So this Plato's cave has some parts to it that are important. So there's a wall here. Can everybody see this wall I'm showing? Yeah. And then there are these humans holding up various clay characters. There's looks like a horse or maybe a steer. And then the third one looks to be just a Grecian vase, right? An urn, a Grecian urn. And so those are meant to be the actual reality, the pure forms, right? And then here's this poor person chained to the other side of the wall, can't see behind him, can only see the projection caused by this fire of the actual clay figures onto the cave wall. See the projections? And for this poor guy chained to the wall, maybe he thinks there are two animals he recognizes and another animal that's very scary because it's got these big ears and these sort of holes and who knows, can't see its snout. So it's not clear how dangerous it is. A very fearful figure, perhaps. And here's the sun up above and coming down into the cave by the ladder. So what does this have to do with a Bayesian hierarchical model? So let me ask you some rhetorical questions. I know you can't answer, but I'll nevertheless answer the question. Where is reality? So reality are these clay figurines, right? And where's the scientist? The scientist is the person chained to the wall who can't directly observe these figurines, right? Instead, the scientist can observe an imprecise version of nature, can see what he's seeking only in terms of the shadows that are being cast by this fire. Right? So what does this have to do with science? These are our data. The images are our data. The figurines are the actual values that we wish we knew. We don't see them, we see noisy versions, sometimes perturbed versions or distorted versions. So where's the scientist? The scientist is chained to the wall, unable to see what's actually happening in nature and only able to infer what's happening from imprecise measures. Okay, so that's Plato's cave. Now let's do a statistical version of that. And actually, just go back for a minute. What are we interested in this individualized patient's case? We're interested in what their actual disease state is. Yeah. So these figurines are the actual disease state of the patient, the underlying mechanisms that are giving rise to symptoms. And the images on the wall are the symptoms. And here we are, the clinician, trying to make sense of what's happening in this patient using imperfect measures. Okay, so we're going to now build a model, a statistical model with that idea. So eta is the Greek letter for H, which stands for health. So this is I is the person, the individual of interest, and T is time. So we're here observing a patient's actual health state, the actual health state change over time. And we're going to let delta represent a categorical indicator of whether this patient's in one, or this is just going to be a category that captures the patient. Is this patient, say, stable or progressing rapidly or getting better? So this is going to be a category of patient in a moment. But this is the patient's actual health trajectory or disease trajectory. Okay. And then what do we want to do? We want to intervene. Clinicians intervene to try to improve the patient's health state. So Rx stands for a treatment that is given, and that treatment causes a change in the health state. And how much of a change does it cause? It's reflected in this random variable beta sub I. Why is it beta sub I? Because the treatment will affect different patients differently. So this is the treatment effect for patient I who's in category I. Okay. And then there's some other covariates that also affect health. Let's not worry about the sex, age, and things like that. This wouldn't be a very interesting model if all we talked about was this underlying latent health state, because we don't see that. What we see instead are the imprecise projections of the health state into our measurements. Why? Sometimes we have missing data, not observed, but often it's observed. And there are parameters, phi sub I, which tell us how eta causes the measurements, that tells us something about the characteristics of the measurement process. Okay, and there's only one more step here. Now, how do physicians decide whether to, and nurses decide whether to give a new medication or not, right? Do they get to see the health state? No, they only get to see the imprecise measures of the health state, right? And so the idea is that they decide what treatment to give next based upon what they have measured as outcomes for the patient's health state. So health states in the past, measurements of the health state cause treatments in the future. So let's take this. This is patient Joe, right? This is his model. And now let's put him up in that corner and acknowledge that if all we ever had was patient Joe, we'd be in big trouble. We need to have a population of patients like Joe that we can reference him against, right? So we have the same model for these four patients, right? You see them here. And what we can then assume is that there's a hierarchy to the model. So Joe has his own treatment effect, beta I, and Sarah has hers, and Ian has his, and Bao has hers, right? And there's all these individual treatment effects, but it's reasonable to assume, because we're all human beings, that treatments which benefit some of us likely benefit many of us. And it's not everybody, but there's something to be learned about the treatment effect for one person from what happened from the other people. So we assume that there's a distribution of treatment effects with mean beta and covariance matrix sigma, which tells us how heterogeneous these treatment effects are among people, right? And similarly, the other parameters are joined together in another level of the hierarchy. So this is now a formalism that allows us to see that what we would say the treatment benefit's going to be for Joe is related to what has happened for the other people for their treatment effects. And if we knew something about them, say from them being prior patients, we'd be able to make a prediction about what was going to happen for Joe if we treated Joe with one treatment or with another. Okay. And now if you take that, this is the Johns Hopkins population, you put it up there, and now you have lots of health systems. And when you're interested in Joe, who's a patient at Johns Hopkins, right? But we have the same data from systems around the world. We would be able to bring the evidence that's relevant from all these other people to bear on Joe when we need to make a decision for him. Okay, so what are the key ideas here? This is just a formalism that enables us to learn from a population of past patients about a single patient's health state, about the trajectory they're on, and about the likely benefits of treatments. And what we're doing is combining an individual's data with data on a reference population of otherwise similar people, either from the same information system, same health system, or from perhaps others. And it gives us the ability to make predictions and to then observe outcomes that correspond to those predictions and then continuously improve this model. And there is the possibility also of explicit reliance on prior medical knowledge. These treatments are usually tested in advance and, you know, by the Food and Drug Administration or the comparable systems in other countries. And so there's lots of prior medical knowledge that we can bring to bear in these systems. And when I tell the story and people say, well, come on, that's just, you know, that's sort of a simple model and so forth, I just like to remind myself to feel positive that in current practice, which I've got to observe quite a bit, at best what's happened is doctors are trying to remember how it turned out and nurses trying to remember how it turned out when that treatment was used for patients like this one in the past. There's, you know, there are guidelines, there's expert opinion, but there's currently no formal use of, very little formal use of data. And in fact, the systems that in the United States govern medical practice prevent clinicians from seeing anything other than the data for that one patient at hand at a time. So, oops, that's some Hebrew up there, but this is George Boole. And who does anybody know who that is? Yes, that's right. It's Thomas Bayes. And so what's happening in expert systems in medicine is we used to try to use Boolean logic. If the measurements above this, do that. If this is measurements above that and they have this history, do this other thing. There was these sort of deterministic rules, and we're shifting from George Boole's methods to Thomas Bayes' methods. We're going from Boole to Bayes, or as I like to say, Boole à Bayes. And so this is a dish I once had in Australia, and it was absolutely delicious. Or maybe I had it in the south of France, I can't remember. Or maybe I had it in both places. But there you go. There's the shift from Boole to Bayes. So I have two examples. Let's see. So I had one vote for Australia. Okay, we're going to go to Australia. Let me just get out of this for a second. We'll do some COVID data, and then we'll come back if we have time. If not, we'll just leave it in the notes for you to see. So let's see. This is just a quick story about COVID-19. You know, it only came to Maryland in February, I think it was, 2020. So that's only how long ago? 19 months, something like that. And when it arrived, we knew nothing about it. You know, there was something to a little bit of public literature, no clinical trials, no nothing. And this guy here, Brian Garibaldi, was the chief COVID physician. I would be lying if I didn't tell you that he also was President Trump's doctor, one of his many doctors, when he was very nearly deathly ill with COVID, and he helped save our president. And then these are other people, two students, an MD PhD student and a PhD student in biostatistics, and the vice dean for research in our medical school, and a young assistant professor in our department, Aki Nishimura. So these are the people whose work I'm going to share with you. And let me just illustrate the use of that Bayesian hierarchical model in the COVID context. So there are four questions that we've been building our system to be able to answer. What is my current disease state? And how do I compare to other patients? In other words, where do I fit in the story of this disease? Am I doing well? Am I doing poorly? What's my disease trajectory? These are the questions clinicians ask their doctors. Am I sort of like other patients, or am I sort of other? Is there a subset of patients that look like me? And among the available treatments, which is best for people like me? You know, if I'm like this subset of low risk people, which treatment is best for the low risk people? Or if I'm at grave danger, which treatment is best for that group? So these are the questions that we want to be able to answer with the system I just described to you. Okay. So here's some COVID data. So let me just say that this system that I've just described, we are actually building it. We have built it and simple versions of it. And with COVID, it had a huge impact on our capacity to make progress because the place was scared to death with COVID, and we got a lot of resources to do things we hadn't been able to do in the past. And so we were able to capture all of the COVID data for the first, well, for all of our patients. We've had about 9,000 patients so far. And and we've been able to not only capture the data in our electronic health record, we've been able to jailbreak the data from the electronic health record, put it out into the cloud, allow teams of people to analyze the data out in the cloud, to be able to develop tools, and then to put those tools back into the electronic health record so that we can see some of what's happening in real time and grade our patients in terms of those questions that I just asked. So I'm going to illustrate some of that here now, just a little bit, but it's been a very exciting time for us. So let's just look at some COVID data. So one thing about COVID is we measure lots of biomarkers. So here are just three of them that indicates a patient's health, the so-called SaO2, SpO2 ratio. It's in simplest terms, how well you're exchanging oxygen as a function of the pressure in your lung, and it's a measure of the lung's efficiency. So if this number is for a healthy person's about 500, and it goes down as low as 100 for a very sick COVID patient and everything in between. And what I'm showing here are for the first about 1,000 patients, their trajectories, their noisy measurements of SaO2, SpO2 ratio. And I'm showing you the population average here, which fortunately is getting better. And then I put a colored dot at the end of the curve because there's a competing risk going on in patients. They're either going home, having been avoided the worst outcomes of COVID, that's a blue dot, or they get ventilated, that's a green dot. Ventilated means you put a tube down into your lung and we help you breathe, and it's a very dangerous procedure and it's not a good outcome, but anyway, it's one of the outcomes that can happen. And then you can also die before you're ventilated. Those are the red dots, right? And then I have the same thing for the not only lung efficiency, but body temperature and pulse. Body temperature turns out not to be very interesting, but we have like six or eight of these. And what I'm going to do is illustrate for you the methodology that was developed to monitor, one of the methodologies that were developed to monitor patient progress. So this is the sort of traditional prospective look at data. Time zero is when a patient enters the hospital. But it turns out it's also maybe even more useful to think of this data retrospectively if what you're trying to do is use past patients to help us see what's happening to current patients. So rather than having time zero be the when you're admitted to the hospital and having the colored dots indicate what happened to you, let me stratify the patients by what happened to them, discharged, died, or were ventilated. And let me now show their curves relative to time zero, which is the date they were discharged or the date they died or the date they were ventilated. So zero is now the date of the event. Okay. And so I have that for lung efficiency, for temperature, and for pulse. Okay. And you can see now there are big differences in lung efficiency having to do with what your outcome is. You could see that over here as well, but it's even more graphic now. And if I look at this picture, I've just put all those curves on the same graph. So this on the left here are the people who had their event at time zero, and the red were the people who died at time zero. The green were the people who were ventilated at time zero, and the blue were the people who went home at time zero. And I'm showing you the estimated smooth curves for all the people in these lines in the background. And the width of the average lines reflects just how many people there were that went into making that average, right? And then this green group that gets ventilated, they're not done. They're now shifting to the next phase of the model, which shows if you're ventilated, you either go on and go home being discharged, or if you're ventilated and you don't go home to be discharged, you're going to die. And so you can see what the SpO2 FiO2 ratios are for those two subsets in the second phase for the ventilated group. So are you with me? This we call a retrospective longitudinal model. And what we've done is used those Bayesian hierarchical models in reverse time. We've basically built a model to say, given whatever your data is going along here, we're gonna build a Gaussian hierarchical model. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about that, but just it's a standard longitudinal analysis where we estimate the mean curve condition on which group you're in and the covariance matrix among the repeated observations. So we build up a likelihood function for each person's curve but conditioned on what their outcome was. So this is a model of the conditional distribution of the biomarkers, and there are three of them, and we're going to do it in multivariate space. So we have a trajectory in multivariate space, but conditioned on which outcome you had, right? And so what we're going to then do is look at each patient. We won't know what their outcome is going to be, but we'll see what their curve looks like. And we also won't know where to put it in this retrospective model because we don't know what their event time is. But if we assign them to a given event time and we assign them to a given outcome, we can ask the question, how much is their data we've seen to date like the data that we saw for the people who had each of those outcomes on each of those future dates? And in so doing, we can learn how to predict what that person's outcome is going to be. And here's just a very quick overview of how this method works. So the first thing we have to do is say what we can say about a patient from baseline. So given when they show up with us, we have their baseline biomarkers, I'm going to call biomarkers Y, and we have their characteristics X. And what we need to do is predict an initial probability distribution of them having each type of event. Remember, there are three types of event: discharge, die, or ventilated, on each future day, right? And we can train up that model, which is just a model for the conditional distribution of the day. T is the day of the event, capital T, and W sub capital T is which event happened on that day. So we need to take the baseline characteristics, Y0 and X, and train a model that calculates, that tells us the probability before we've seen any biomarkers in the intervening time of having a particular event, an event of a particular type on a particular future day, given their baselines. Okay, and I'm gonna skip over this quickly, but that's easy to do. We do it with what's called competing risks models. Just think of it as doing multinomial logistic regression, where you're modeling the probability of the events happening on each future day of each future type. Okay, so just bear with me just for a moment if that isn't clear. I'm going to call this the prior distribution. It's based upon seeing only the baseline characteristics. This is just projecting what are the likely events on each of the future days. And then I talked you through the likelihood function already. We're going to calculate the likelihood of the multivariate biomarker process, Y, which we see on a person. We don't know when their event's going to be or what type it'll be, but what we can do is put this person at each, at their event at each future day tau and make it of each future type M, right? So these are the arguments and the likelihood given their data to date. And that retrospective model will tell us the likelihood if they're going to have their event on this day, tau, and this type M, it'll tell us the likelihood of seeing these data Y. That's what the retrospective model can tell us, right? And then we use Bayes' rule to calculate what we want to know. What we want to be able to predict is, what's your probability of having your event on future date, capital T, event type W, given you made it to a particular day, and given all the biomarkers that we saw from the beginning up to that day, added in with the basic measures at baseline and the kind of person it is. And this is just a function of those two previous equations. We know this term here, this is the likelihood function. This is the probability of the biomarkers given the baseline events. And this is the prior, this is the likelihood function. This is the prior distribution that we have. And this is just Bayes' rule, which gives, takes that likelihood function and multiplies by it, by those prior probabilities, and then makes them sum to one. Okay, so let me show you a movie of this of happening. Okay, I'm going to stop it. And so now look with me on the left here. I hope this thing doesn't run off with me. So this is for a patient. Here's what we know about the patient. This is one piece of data. You see that little dot? This is their SaO2, FiO2 ratio, SpO2, FiO2 ratio here. And they had a value of 100. Remember I said that's a very sick person. 500 is normal, right? They had a fairly normal temperature and they had a fairly normal pulse, okay? And the prior model, using just the prior model, which is shown up here in the upper left corner, this is dark is high probability, light is low probability. Looking down here, this is high probability, low probability, the color scale. Yeah. So based upon the prior information, that is the baseline information, their highest probability is that they'll be vented, right? And then if they don't get vented immediately, it sort of goes down in probability. And then the chance of them dying gets higher and the chance of them being discharged isn't very high, really. And so you can see over here on the right at baseline, they have a 67% chance of being vented, a 23% chance of dying, and only 8% being discharged. And that's because they came in with a really almost dysfunctional lung. And then what's being shown here to the right is a prediction of what the trajectory will look like if they have their event of each of the different kinds. Blue is discharged, green is vented, red is dying. If they have their event on each of the future days. So in other words, if this, given this person's here and they get discharged 3 days, first of all, the size of the dots say how likely that is. You can see it's not very likely. And in fact, they, all those dots are small enough, they only add up to 8%. These dots on the green are the biggest one. You see that being vented in the next couple of days is most likely, right? You can see them here. This is just the different biomarkers showing the same information. How will the biomarker trajectories look in order to get you to that event, and what's the probability of getting there? So this shows if you're going to go home, you got to get your lung function up much higher than it is right now, right? And you're, if you're going to die, your temperature is probably going to go up quite a bit before you do. And although this scale is very small, these are all fairly normal and similarly. So it shows which things are most likely to happen in the future and what the trajectories are going to look like in order to get there. And now we can let the thing run. Okay, so now we followed this person for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, they're on their sixth day and we're updating the probabilities every day. Now, your venting probability is down to 22%, death to 10%, and there's now a 68% chance you're going to be discharged. This is doing that exact 2x2 table, but in a more complicated context, right? And now you can see you're likely to go home if you're going to go home, even in the next 3 or 4 days, right? And the risk of dying is small into the distant future, but it's, if you're going to die, it's going to be, have to be a real reversal in your lung efficiency, right? And so forth, right? So you can see, and let's just let this play out now. And we get this every day and we can put this back into the medical record. Although we've done much simpler versions, this is for statisticians, not for clinicians at the moment. And so you can see to the end. And what happened to this patient is they just kept getting better and better. And their probability, they're now up to 95% chance of going home, and it's going to be in the next day or two. And there'd have to be a huge reversal for them to either be vented or to be to die. Okay, so let me just run that. All right, so how am I doing on time? I've got a few more minutes, and then I'll stop.
Yes, Scott, we started a bit late. I would say if you went another 5 minutes, that would be great.
Okay, I'll try to do it even a little bit less, but that is fairly standard statistics. It's not standard to capture the data, to get it where you can analyze it, to analyze it, to get it validated and get it back into the clinical record in front of the patient. That took a lot of work, and we've got it done. And there's some other methods that we're actually featuring where we can actually tell the doctors when they come in, they can see they're on a shift, they can see all their patients, and they're all ranked in terms of those probabilities from highest risk to lowest risk over the next 6 hours, over the next 24 hours, over the next 7 days. And we have a way to actually use it as a teaching tool so the doctor can click on the probability and then see. We're actually showing them decision trees rather than those ones I just showed you. And they can see which of the measurements that they're making is the measurement that's causing the patient to be rated as a high or low risk. So it's also a useful teaching tool. But I want to get on just for the last minute to really exciting opportunities. Which treatment is best for me, doctor, given my outcomes to date? You know, for example, should I be intubated today or can we wait another couple of days? Because intubation's not great, right? So that decision is taken by doctors in our clinic every day. And they're all making different decisions. They're all winging it basically as best they can. You know, they're using their clinical senses, but they can't use the results from the other patients to help inform their decision until now. So this is, first of all, now the question, which treatment should I use? That's a really hard problem. And this is really what I'm calling a first try. And what we're doing that's different than what I just showed you is everything I showed you a minute ago was looking at many biomarkers and how they change over time. But now what we have to do is model both the biomarkers and the competing events. That's what we were doing before. But now we also have to model the treatment choice because we don't have any randomized trials of whether it's good to intubate earlier or later. So we can't randomize our patients. So what we have to do is model the treatment choice and then take that treatment choice and integrate it with what we know about the relationship between biomarkers and competing events and model them all jointly. And so let me just give a flavor of how this works. So excuse this, this is very messy. Just look at the solid lines for a second. The other things are, and I apologize for the changing in some of the notation. E stands for event. And so you either have your event and the events are the same ones as before. You get intubated, you get discharged, you die. You either have your each kind of event or not on successive days. So here's time and the events occurring. Here are the biomarkers, right? The biomarkers that we measure and they're changing through time. And the biomarkers have an effect on the events, right? And the events have an effect on the biomarkers, right? And then this is the treatment choice, A. Is treatment choice. And the treatment choice at a given day affects the events and it affects the biomarkers. And the treatment choices are affected by the biomarkers and by the previous events. So each of these things affect each other over time, okay? In a feedback system, basically. And then we want to be able to make a prediction about an individual, and we want to acknowledge that there's heterogeneity in whether a person's going to get treated because of random effects BA and random effects BY and random effects BE, which are jointly distributed. And these things then, in terms of the causal model, these are unobserved quantities and they then play a role. You know, for example, BA causes whether you're going to get treated or not, right? And therefore, it's also related to the other events through the relation that they have with each other. This gets a little bit complicated, but just bear with me. And now I'm going to turn a black box and I'm going to show you what we get out the other end. So what we basically do is sit here. This is the biomarker, again, SaO2, FiO2 ratio. This is the one patient's biomarker. It's what actually happened, right? And then we sit here on day 12 and we decide whether to vent them or not, right? We either vent them on day 12 or we, I think that, and this, I don't have it here. I think we simulated that they would stay unvented for 5 days. So what we do is we take exactly the kind of method I described in the first example, but with this more complicated model that requires us to model the probability of getting the treatment. And we say, suppose we force the treatment to happen today, right? What's going to happen in the future? And if instead of forcing it to happen today, we say we're not going to do it today, we're going to do our best to leave it for 5 days, what would happen in that case, right? And so this is for one patient with their trajectory over time. And this is the same data. This is just a different scale here. And what we show here are the trajectories in gray in a series of simulated futures and the events that occur. So this person is vented, and you can see that the model, as it's estimated here now, says that it's a lot better because you're really comparing this group to this group, right? There's very few people, if this person doesn't get vented, there are very few simulated futures where they go home and a lot of simulated futures where they die. Whereas here it's about 50-50. And this parameter B sub A is the likelihood that the patient would be vented. And it's not estimable from the data. So what we have here is a range of possible values for B sub A being at the 25th, 50th, or 75th percentile of the population. And you can see this qualitatively and also ignoring the possibility, saying that there was no heterogeneity in the chance of being intervened upon, being vented on that day. You can see that the results aren't sensitive to this parameter, which we can't estimate, and neither are these. And so this, for this person on this day, this would be a clean decision that you'd probably want to not try to delay the venting, right? This person needs the venting, and this is borrowing strength from what happened from all the other patients and bringing it to bear in a model that is not true. It's not a correct model, but hopefully it's a useful model. And it's an illustration of trying to use this idea to make decisions, help clinicians have informed decisions. We'll have to come back to give some of the technical details because there's lots of technical details. There's lots more work to be done there. So let me just close by saying, what did we do? We illustrated the use of dynamic Bayesian hierarchical models as a useful tool for bringing evidence in front of the clinicians when they make decisions about particular patients. And all we're doing is looking at what happened to the prior patients who were in similar situations and trying to bring that information along with the clinical trials data that we have to make recommendations for clinicians. It's potentially useful, but as in statistical terms, but it's only ever useful in clinical terms if you can communicate this to the clinicians in a way that they can then make their own decisions, but decisions that are better informed by what happened to future patients. And I skipped this, we won't talk about that. And let me just close by saying there's a US gold field of $1.3 trillion in annual waste waiting to be mined by young people like yourselves. And maybe by doing it, if we get some of that money, we could reinvest it in other things. So there's a Australian gold rush if you guys come help us solve our problem. Let me close by showing a little bit of the history. So Here's Jeff Watson, who is the professor I talked about. This is John Tukey. John Tukey, and this is David Cox, recruited, David Cox was the professor of this guy, Peter Bloomfield. Peter Bloomfield and John Tukey and Jeff Watson were the professors at Princeton when Noel and I were students there. And here's Jeff Watson at the board. This is the blackboard where I actually took my oral exam. I still get the heebie-jeebies looking at it. And who are these guys? Anybody notice anybody? Ah, there's Noel back in the days when he was when he had a beard. And Noel, this is Paul Velleman, I think, right?
Great. Yep.
And who's this?
That's Tony Kwan.
Tony Kwan. Yep. Great. And only reason I want to put it is I wanted to sort of connect to Australia. So Jeff Watson was Australian. When he was the professor, he brought this guy. Does anybody know who this is? I know Noel does, but anybody else? Terry Speed. Terry Speed came to Princeton and taught Introduction to Linear Models when I was a first year graduate student. So I was in his class and I got to know him a little bit. And this guy, Peter Diggle, who you had in this lecture last year, he doesn't get red. He's not Australian, but he's half Australian. It's a mix of purple and red. And he introduced me to Terry. Actually, was the guy who invited me to come to Australia in 1986, where I met Terry, who was the head of CSRO DMS at the time, and introduced me to Nick Fisher, who came and visited lots of times. And one reason I'm showing this is because this was one of my close colleagues in Johns Hopkins, who's now the head of biostatistics for the Dana-Farber Cancer Center in Harvard University, Rafael Irizarry. And when he came to Johns Hopkins, I was chair, and he was interested in this thing called genomics that was just starting. And I knew Terry Speed and called him up, said, will you take this guy under your wing? And he did. And he came off to Australia and spent many months with Terry and became really one of the bright lights in the field. I also got invited to Sydney by Mark Woodward some years later and had a great time. And so it's a pleasure to be with you at Wollongong. And thanks very much for your attention. Here's some references for people who want them. And here's a picture of Australia from the view of Baltimore.